We've read last week from Acts chapter 10 how Peter and Cornelius got together. Peter got into Cornelius' house and they both introduced themselves, gave a short summary of how it came about and what they had experienced before, and how the Lord orchestrated all this. And then Peter begins his sermon. And yeah, as I said last week, it's Peter Power Preaching, PPP. And it's really so. But we read last week only the first sentence that he spoke, which came down to the fact that God does not respect persons. God is no respecter of persons. That is what he had learned, how God had worked in him. And that had enabled it for him to be there and to speak to these people that were not Jews. They were mostly or all Romans, and in any way so-called Gentiles. And now he continues his message. And so that's what we will read now. That's from Acts 10. We start at verse 36. And I read through to 43. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word, I say, you know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee, after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him God raised up the third day, and shewed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before of God, even unto us, who did eat and drink with him, after he rose from the dead. And he commanded to preach unto the people, and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be judge of quick and dead. To him give all the prophets witness, that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. Peter here continues to preach in the same way as he preached before to the Sanhedrin, which we read in Acts chapter 4. It's a very similar message. Actually, it's the same message, but similar words. Comes down to the fact that Jesus was crucified, he died, he was raised up on the third day, and he offers remission of sins. Now, he preaches this message to a completely different audience than what we, of course, had in Acts 4, where it was the Sanhedrin, his accusers. And they were trying to convict him of something. And here, his audience are people that are eager to hear the good news. They want to hear this, whereas the ones in Acts 4, they didn't want to hear this. So, a complete different audience, but the message is exactly the same. And that is how it should be and how it should always be. The message of the gospel is always the same. To whomever you preach it, it's always the same. It doesn't change. There is no different gospel for different people. And of course, Paul later speaks about it. There is only one gospel. And everything else is not the gospel. And in this this compact sermon, he gives 12 attributes of Jesus. And let's go over them, because it's good for us to be reminded of what we actually believe. Who is the Jesus we believe in? First of all, he says Jesus was baptized as man. And you can add also as an example to men. He was baptized. That's an example. And we will find out later, of course, that these people will also be baptized. They will follow the example, as all of us do. He says Jesus was anointed with the Holy Spirit and with power. That's the second one. The third one, Jesus did healing and delivered the oppressed. That's an interesting one, because he says healing all that were oppressed of the devil. He doesn't say the healing all that were oppressed with a disease or with a sickness, but that were oppressed of the devil. And we spoke about this, of course, in the past. The true healing is this, is deliverance from oppression of the enemy. That is true healing. Physical healing is, I would say, it's bonus. And of course, Jesus did many times, as did also Peter and others. But most of the times you see that the physical healing is actually a sign to the unbeliever. But it is the remission of sins, the deliverance of the oppression of the devil and of demonic powers. That is the true healing. And so he makes this clear here. And the fourth thing he says, that Jesus did it with the power of God, that God was with him. He didn't do it on his own account. As man, he did it with the power of God. Also, the fifth, Jesus did it before eyewitnesses. It's not just myths, it's not just stories of hearsay, but there are many witnesses. And of course, while Peter speaks, many of them are still alive, he himself being one of them. So it is genuine, it's real. It's not a matter of you may accept it or not. These are the facts. And that by the way, that resounds until this day. There are very few people that have so many historical accounts than Jesus does. And if we take the whole Bible, there is no historical document in the existence of mankind that has been preserved so well, that has so many translations, so many ancient fragments, scrolls. So to doubt the reality of it, and the historical reality of it, is really silly. But many do, unfortunately, and at the same time they believe other things of which there is hardly any or no proof. Anyway, Jesus did it before eyewitnesses. Then the sixth thing he says, Jesus was crucified. Jesus was crucified. And he was raised from the dead. He was resurrected. And again he says there were witnesses to this. This is not a myth. These are the facts. And he adds even to that, we ourselves, he is one of them. We saw him and we ate with him, just to say he was flesh and blood after he rose from death. He commanded, this eighth thing, he commanded his followers to preach the gospel. That is the commission that Jesus gave to his followers. And so that's exactly what Peter is doing there. So that's actually indeed a commandment. It's not optional. It's good news. It is personal, but it's not to keep only for yourself. It is to share with others. Then the ninth thing, Jesus is ordained by God to be judge of the entire world. He is the judge of all. So that's another point. He is a judge of the living and the dead, he says. So not only of the living, but also of the dead. He is a judge of all, which means all will be resurrected and judged. And we know that, of course, from the book of Revelation, chapter 20. Jesus is the one who was foretold by the prophets. This is also a very important point that he makes. It's not just someone who came up and we made him into the Messiah. No, he fulfills the prophecies. He is the one who was foretold. This is what it is. And Lastly, he offers remission of sins. This is, of course, the greatest thing. This makes this news into good news. This makes it into the gospel. So Peter emphasizes that they ate and drank with Jesus, showing that it was a real resurrection, not an appearance, as some believe. And he preaches the gospel in a nutshell, you can say. It's a short, very compact message that contains all this. The main theme in this is that Jesus will judge all, the living and the dead, but that in itself would not be so good news, because, yeah, how are you judged? But there is remission of sins. That makes it good news. And what makes it even better news is that, for who is this remission of sins? And that's with which he ends: to whosoever believeth in him. Whosoever believeth in him. That is the difference. So he ends basically how he began. He began to say that God is no respecter of persons, and he ends to say it is for whoever believes in him. So that includes also non-Jews. And that is really the change that we see here in the church. It has maybe not been said so explicitly before, but the practice was that until that moment, practically all believers, all Christians, were former Jews. And the few that were not, they were Judaized. That, by the way, would still continue for a long time. We see, of course, later when Paul writes to the Galatians, this, it's all about that, how many of the Christian Jews demand from the Gentile Christians, so the Jewish Christians demand from the Gentile Christians that they adhere to the Jewish traditions. So they want to Judaize them. And Paul writes explicitly against that. By the way, even in the letter, in his epistle to the Galatians, he speaks also against Peter, because Peter still at that time more or less agrees with that. So even though he's changed here, it's so rooted in him that later it still comes up again, and he is still moving toward this Judaic traditions. It's so very hard for some things to change in us. But the good news here, for all those that were present and listening there, is that it was for them. It was for them. All they had to do is to believe. And they were there, gathered, full of anticipation, ready to hear actually this. This is what they needed to hear, but also what they wanted to hear. And they got exactly this good news. And so what happens? That's what then follows in verse 44. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. So, very interesting what happens here. Again, I have to say, it was for sure so that there were Gentiles that had received the gospel before, since the days of Pentecost. But this here was a clear milestone in the history of the church. The gift of salvation was for everyone. That was something that was really new. It was for everyone, whosoever believes. It was new. It was not new, actually, but it was new in the mindset of the believers of those days. for whosoever believes. And they believed with all their heart, the hearts that only God knew, but it was made manifest, it became evident through the miracle of them speaking, and pay attention to the verbiage here, speaking with, not in, with tongues, plural. I will say a few more things about it later on, but the words used are very important. So, even like the apostles had done at first, that is what Peter says, as well as we, he compares it with himself and his fellow apostles. So that was a confirmation to the former Jews that had come with Peter. It says, those of the circumcision, Peter had brought with him six men, as we will read in the next chapter, chapter 11. He had six men with him. They were all former Jews. They were of the circumcision, like Peter himself. So for them, they were astonished. For them, this was amazing. How could Gentiles receive the same gift of the Holy Spirit and be accepted by God? This was revolutionary. They were astonished. And the fact that they were astonished means that this was new to them. This was new. Gentiles could become brothers in Christ without becoming Jew first and without keeping all the Jewish traditions. So this was a new thing. And that proved that, making this evident, this was the whole purpose of this miracle of them speaking with tongues. This was a sign to prove it without, how you say, beyond the shadow of doubt, that this was from God and this was genuine. If you think of this, Paul speaks about this later also to the Corinthians, and they also display this spirituality, but I have to put it between quotation marks, because he's actually rebuking them for misusing it and for even attributing non-spirituality to the Holy Spirit. So he begins, of course, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 to explain actually what is the Holy Spirit and what is it for. But then in chapter 14 he gets down to this specific gift. And he says that this is, and the, all the gifts, or the manifestations of the Holy Spirit, is better to say than maybe, that all these are signs for the unbeliever, and for the edification of the body of the church. So these are the two things, for the edification of the church and as signs for the unbelievers. And with that, he's in line with what John writes in his gospel. If you read the four gospels, you see that mostly the miracles that Jesus does are called miracles, but John doesn't do that. He calls them signs. And that's actually a better term, because they have a purpose. They're not just miracles to astonish someone. They are signs to prove something, to be the evidence of something. And like in this case, this, what happens here, was unique. It is not a common thing throughout the book of Acts. And it is not a common thing in subsequent Christian experience in the book of Acts, and also in the epistles that follow later. It was not a common experience for the Christians to be instantly born again while they were listening to the gospel. This is not a common thing. Also, to, on top of that, immediately show this manifestation of the Holy Spirit. So why did it happen here, in this way? Well, it was appropriate, it was necessary for this occasion, because of the uniqueness of it, because of the new development in the church, the open, full inclusion of Gentiles, of non-Jews, into the church. The gospel is for everyone. For God, this has always been like that. For Jesus, has also been clear about this. But in the Jewish mindset, this was not so. And now this was changing. And so they received the Holy Spirit. Or as it's worded here, the Holy Spirit fell on them. It is the same Spirit that the apostles had received, obviously. And so it manifests in the exact same way. It's the same blessing that the apostles received on the day of Pentecost. And it's interesting, and not by chance, obviously, that Paul says they received the Holy Spirit as well as we. Who is the we? It's not, in general, all Christians up to that moment. It becomes more clear after Peter and the six men return to Jerusalem, and they are again in the fellowship of the other Christians of the circumcision, the former Jews. They rebuke him. How could you do this? How could you go into the house of Gentiles and preach to them Jesus Christ? And then Peter gives an account of what happened, and this is in Acts 11, verse 15. He says to them, "And as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them, as on us at the beginning." That's what he says. So now he gives his own personal account of what happens here in the house of Cornelius, and he says, the same thing happened as on us at the beginning. What is the beginning? That is the day of Pentecost. That is, so the us is him and the 11. That's what he compares it to. He makes it even more clear in verse 17 of Acts 11. He says, "For as much then as God gave them the like gifts as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God?" So if this was a common thing that happened all the time, he would not have said, like on us at the beginning. He would have said something like, as it happened on all of us. Or as it happened to all the Jews. Something like that. You have to take into account, and I put this timeline up, that between Pentecost and this event in the house of Cornelius are 8 years. So if this had happened all the time throughout these 8 years to the thousands, actually tens of thousands of Jews that had become believers in Jesus Christ, then why would he compare it with an event 8 years ago? It would be a normal thing. When someone become a Christian, this is what would happen. And he would say something like, this happened. It happened to them like to all of us. But he doesn't. He compares it specifically with what happened to him and the apostles at the beginning. And in fact, if we go through the book of Acts and we read carefully, there are only 3 instances where this miracle or sign is specifically mentioned. So the first one is in Acts chapter 2. It is the day of Pentecost. And if you look there to who it happened, it were Jews, it were the apostles, and it were how many? 12. It says in Acts 2, Peter and the 11, is what it says. It were 12 because, of course, in Acts chapter 1, we read that Judas was replaced. So there were 12. It happened to 12 and they were Jews. When did it happen in their life, in their walk with the Lord? It happened long after they were baptized. It was not they were baptized and then they began to speak with tongues, but they were baptized long before. I say this on purpose because there is this idea that it is linked to baptism, but actually these accounts show that it's not necessarily so. So 8 years pass and now we are in the house of Cornelius, with Cornelius' family and friends, and this miracle happens again. Who are they? They are Gentiles, or non-Jews. And what happens, what we just read, is that While Peter spoke, they were filled with the Spirit and they began to speak with tongues. And because of that, Peter says, now we have to baptize them. Who are we to say that we should forbid them water? So what we see is that they receive this gift first and then they are baptized. So here is the order is reversed. How many were there? We don't know. We actually don't know. But they were not very, very many because they fitted all in the house of Cornelius. So they were not like 100. If I would make a guess, I would say there were 24. But that's just my guess, so don't hold me to that. But why do I say that? Because that would fit the wave offering on Pentecost. That would fit Rachel and Leah. That would fit the 24 elders in heaven. It goes very deep, actually. But that is whenever God shows that there is two groups that are all part of His church. Jews and Gentiles, again, Rachel and Leah are the type of that. But you see this number 24, it's 2 times 12. So that would be my guess. But again, we don't know. So, but it would be something in that order of magnitude. And then the third time we see specifically mentioned this miracle of speaking with tongues in the book of Acts is in Acts chapter 19. In Acts chapter 19, and who are they? They are Greeks. They are Greeks. They are called, by the way, disciples. However, they have never even heard of the Holy Spirit. They don't know what the Holy Spirit is. They have been not been baptized in the name of Jesus. They have been baptized only with the baptism of repentance, as it's called, the baptism of John the Baptist. And so that's all they know. So they have a doctrine that is incomplete. And so Paul baptizes them again, but now in the name of Jesus. And then this miracle happens again. How many are they? 12. So we see at the beginning and the end it's 12. And in the middle we don't know. But again, the logical thing would be 24. But anyway, a relatively small number. Both are about 8 years apart. So from Pentecost to Cornelius is 8 years. From Cornelius to Acts 19 is 8 to maximum 12 years. So there is quite a gap in between in both cases. For the apostles, it happened long after they were baptized. For Cornelius and his family, it happened before they were baptized. For this group of Greek disciples that had an incomplete doctrine, it happened after they were baptized for the second time. So we see there is no fixed order or pattern between this miracle happening and baptism. And we should not make that because it's really not, the Bible does not say that. Nor is there this doctrine of tarrying that that some promote, that after you have been baptized you have to tarry to wait for the Spirit to fall, which is taken from Acts chapter 1 when Jesus says you wait here in Jerusalem to his disciples. We see that also this does not stand with these other instances. It's not necessarily so. And of course, much, much, much more can be said about it, and maybe I will in another time, as Paul speaks about it a lot. But what is very important to see also is the grammar that's being used. It says here they began to speak with tongues. It is a plural word, tongues, which means just like in Acts 2, it's different languages. So that in Acts 2 it's clear, so that all could understand all that were present there from all these different nations. And that's what it means. That's also what Paul explains to the Corinthians. Anyway, I might go into that deeper another time. it amazed here these Christian Jews that were with Peter. They were astonished. They had not expected this to happen. That makes you wonder, why did they come? Did they come to see and to get confirmation that the Gentiles really did not belong to the church? Maybe that's what they expected, and now they see the opposite and they were astonished. We don't know, but in any case, it was good that Peter had witnesses with him, and that is clear when we see in Acts 11 that he is questioned about this. Now these witnesses could only confirm what he was saying. The promise of the gospel and the promise of the Holy Spirit was just the same for Gentiles as for Jews. They were astonished because it showed that God loved and blessed non-Jews just as much as he did the Jews. God is not a respecter of persons. And so, for the first time, it was obvious that the Gentiles did not have to become Jews first. So now it was only apt that their adoption into the family of God was confirmed with baptism. And so they were baptized. And I have to say again, note that they were born again before they were baptized. And it was manifest through this miracle or sign where they spoke in with tongues. The inclusion of Gentiles into the church astonished the Christian Jews. And this is so ingrained in the Jewish mindset that it cannot be for Gentiles, that for this early church it was very hard to adapt, to change this this paradigm. And of course we have seen in the past chapter God was working with Peter to change his mind to come to this point. And yeah, as I said, later on it will appear that Peter is still somehow struggling with this. But we see it same thing today. In the world today, for Jews, it is so that their faith is exclusive to them. It can actually not be for others. Of course, others can become Jews religiously, but they will never be real Jews in the eyes of a born Jew, an ethnic Jew. And that is sad, and it's also against Scripture. Scripture tells us differently. For example, in Isaiah 60, verses 1 through 3, it says, "Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising." The Gentiles, the nations, non-Israelites, non-Jews. So Isaiah spoke of this already. And when Jesus is born and Joseph and Mary bring him to the temple on the eighth day, there is this old man sitting there, Simeon, and he takes baby Jesus in his arms and he says in Luke 2 verse 32, "A light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." So he too saw this. He obviously knew also the scriptures and he had a correct understanding. And of course then Jesus himself speaks about this as well in numerous occasions. One of them is in John 10 verse 16, where he says, "And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." So it's clear that it has always been God's intention to make his plan of salvation available for everyone, without discrimination. So what we see here is that the church would again make a massive growth spurt. From now on, we will see, we will begin to read how all kinds of areas, cities and peoples are included in the church, in the body of Christ, on a scale that was not possible before. It had already grown by the thousands, tens of thousands, but it was still Judea, Galilee, Samaria, this area. But now it would go beyond. We see also why Paul is sort of parked. He is out of the picture all these years, actually, in Tarsus, because this had to be done first. And we will see right after this, next time, that he will now come back on the scene, and now his work, his ministry can continue. And this is what God had planned for him, to deliver the gospel to the Gentiles. But of course, this core of the church in Jerusalem had to be convinced first that this was what God wanted. And that's what happens here. And this event, you can say in a way, is the very reason that we are here today, and that we have our Bibles, and that we have the gospel, and that we are saved. So this is wonderful, and it's a great event. And so that's why I made this timeline, really to show that these three events in the beginning, the middle, and the end of the book of Acts are really very big events in the growth of the church. Very important things. So it's good to recognize that, and to be grateful for that, because again, that's why we as non-Jews, let's say, as Gentiles, can be Christians and can share in this great plan of salvation that God had prepared before the foundation of the earth. Amen.